anytime she goes away.
All right, thanks everybody. I think we're gonna get started to the next session. So my name's Doug Heath. I'm the research manager with SaskCanola. And I'll be chairing this research update session, which is sponsored by Corteva. So if I can ask everyone to please find their seats. Our first speaker of the session is Dr. Amy Delaquis. Amy's the research manager with Manitoba Canola Growers Association and lives in South Central Manitoba. She completed her PhD at the University of Manitoba, focused on agronomy, and is a certified crop advisor and 4R designated agronomist. She completed her MSc at the University of Alberta in weed science and the Bachelor of Science in Agronomy from U of M. And previously, Amy has worked as a research technician in the soil fertility lab at the U of M and as an agronomist with Pembina Co-op. So Amy will provide us with the MCGA research update.
Thanks, Doug. As mentioned, my name is Amy Delaquis, and I'm the research manager with Manitoba Canola Growers Association. And I'm gonna give you a very quick update into our research program and what we've been doing in 2023. Overall, the main goal of our research program is to fund and invest in projects that match grower priorities and improve the sustainability of Manitoba canola acres. Doing that through increasing and providing stable profits for Manitoba canola acres, providing safe and manageable farm options for producers, as well as reducing the environmental impact of canola while increasing longevity of the canola acres. Our research priorities in general are pretty broad, so increasing canola yield potential and stability, protecting canola yields from current and emerging pests, improving nutrient use efficiency through 4R practices, reducing and improving the environmental impact of canola, reducing harvest and storage losses, and then ensuring a supply of high quality canola for current and future end use demands. So here's a little profile of our current funding breakdown. This can be deceiving because it is based on number of projects and not dollar amounts, but just wanting to highlight that a large number of projects that we fund, which it's pretty safe to say the highest dollar amount is also going into our pest management, disease and insects, as well as genetic improvement and testing. Our newly funded research projects, so these are new since the last research update last year, and projects that have signed contribution agreements in place. So last year's CARP, MCGA funded 4 projects, Verticillium, a blackleg, and a clubroot project, and then a more applied cover cropping for management of flea beetles project with Dr. Yvonne Lawley. We also funded 2 new projects through the Manitoba Whole Farm Committee. So that committee is really, it's funded with MCA and MPSG in Manitoba, and that's really where our soil and water projects tend to fall. So more of the not crop specific projects. And we funded 2 projects this past year, one looking at a soil health for cover crops, and then a surface and tile drainage project in southwest Manitoba. And then for the first time, we also funded projects through ADF. We funded the Prairie Disease Monitoring Network and then the Insect Response to Climate Change project through last year's ADF call. In addition to funding research projects, which is the bulk of our research program, we have strategic priorities to ensure that our program is growing and matching and providing the highest level of return on investment for our membership. So those are connecting on the farm to ensure that new priorities and ideas are centered on farm priorities. Then also providing tangible member value through our research programs and services. So under that umbrella, we have our on-farm research program, as well as our diagnostic services, and then our variety testing. Our research camp program was really where we focused on connecting on the farm. We took a number of researchers this past 2 summers from diverse backgrounds and institutions and took them out to Manitoba canola farms or Manitoba farms on the province to the different growing areas of the province, as well as different types of farm operations, and really allowing them to connect directly with farmers and have those conversations about what their big production problems are and how research can really help them achieve and adopt new production practices on their farm. Again, our canola research on-farm program ran again in 2023. We had added a seed-placed fertilizer toxicity trial for this 2023 season. And then in 2024, this coming season, we are also going to be including cover cropping for flea beetle management trials. And that's a really good example of how this program can be used to collaborate with more traditional research projects. So this is in collaboration with Dr. Yvonne Lawley's CARP project, and really field test some of those promising treatments that are coming out of her more detailed trial. And then we have our pest surveillance initiative, which is an applied research facility in Manitoba. It's based out of Winnipeg, that is owned and operated by MCGA. And we really do use this to provide our free testing to growers. So we provide testing for clubroot, blackleg, verticillium stripe, as well as amaranth ID, which has become more important as water hemp is moving throughout the province. And then also herbicide-resistant kochia testing runs through that lab. And all farmers and agronomists in the province have access to free testing for those. We have pretty consistent sample submission numbers for those programs. A little bit of an increase here in 2023, as the numbers on the screen are what has currently been processed, and there are still samples sitting in the lab waiting to be processed. And then lastly, our canola variety evaluation program. When the prairie-wide CPT program ended after the 2022 season, our MCGA board really thought it was important to have independent third-party canola variety data available to our membership. We didn't have a program in 2023, so we took that as an opportunity to talk to our farmers and survey and gauge support for a program. So essentially, do they support this program? Is it valuable? Will they use the results? What do they need to see in a program? We had over 400 respondents that represented every RM in Manitoba where canola was grown, and really just saw an overwhelming amount of support. So over 94% of the farmers and agronomists that responded to our survey valued the program, they use it in their canola purchasing decisions, and understood that it's a tool. It's one of many tools that they use in their canola variety decisions. So using it paired with industry field scale data, information coming from their retailers, as well as their experience in the past. So with that, we're going to continue to work towards a program for 2024 that meets industry goals, as well as providing farmers with the variety data that they're wanting in Manitoba. With that, I'll thank you. My contact information is on the screen, so if you have any questions or concerns about our programming, feel free to contact me. I'll be here all week, so if you're in person at Canola Week here, feel free to grab me for those conversations as well.
Thanks a lot, Amy. And just for keeping things on time, I think we're going to skip questions for this session. So next, we'll hear a recorded presentation from Kathryn Knodel. So Kathryn is the research coordinator at Alberta Canola and lives in Edmonton. She has a bachelor's of science in biology from the King's University and previously worked as a summer student in pulse field trials for Lakeland College, which is her first exposure to the agricultural research. As research coordinator at Alberta Canola, she oversees the research funding process and plans events such as the Alberta Canola Research Symposium. So Kathryn will provide us with an Alberta Canola research update.
Hello, my name is Kathryn Knodel, and I'm the research coordinator at Alberta Canola. I hope you're all enjoying Canola Week so far. I'm sad I can't be there in person today, but I will be joining on Thursday and look forward to the chance of meeting many of you. I will be giving a brief update on the grower-funded research projects happening on canola in Alberta. Our research committee at Alberta Canola consists of 5 members of our board of directors and has changed a lot since last year. Ellen Hampton became the chair of our committee this year and has been very busy sitting on multiple different external committees to advocate for canola growers. As several of our directors previously on this committee came to the end of their term with us, we welcome directors Paula Law and Cheryl Westman into the research committee this year. Our research committee makes the final decisions regarding research funding. Our committee is invested in finding sustainable and efficient ways to grow and use canola, supporting, connecting, and engaging researchers, and finding research gaps and thus funding research to fill those gaps. Next, I'd like to touch on our research goals with Alberta Canola. They are broad, but help prevent missing a potential opportunity for innovation. First, we aim to find solutions to pest management. Second, find the best way to grow canola. And third, increase the demand for canola. This past year, we focused on the first two research goals with our funding dollars. Alberta Canola invested nearly $900,000 this past year towards 10 new research projects that represent approximately $7.1 million worth of research. For every $1 of farmer levy invested by Alberta Canola, it was matched by more than $7 of investment by research partners and funding programs. This year, we funded several projects through CARP, in addition to projects funded through the Agriculture Funding Consortium. Starting with our first research goal, find solutions for pest management, this goal took precedent this year, and 8 of 10 newly funded projects this year were involved in pest management. One project we funded with Dr. Charles Geddes at the AFC Lethbridge is the Prairie Weed Monitoring Network. We also funded one project in insect management this year, and Dr. Megan Venkoski at AFC Saskatoon is investigating how insects respond to climate change across the prairies. Continuing in the same goal of finding solutions to pest management, over half of our newly funded projects this year were focused on disease. Since 2012, approximately a quarter of Alberta Canola's research funding has been dedicated to disease, which is primarily due to club root research. This year was no exception. This year, we funded three different research projects in club root alone. At the U of A, Dr. Steven Strelkov is looking into club root resistance gene function based on whole genome sequences, genome editing, and resistance phenotypes. Also at the U of A, we funded a project with Dr. Habib Rahman, where he is evaluating agenome genes for resistance to club root pathotypes. Our third club root project this year is with Dr. Adele Perez-Lopez at the University of Laval, where he is looking to understand how club root pathogen kinases play a role in club root disease progression and resistance. And just note, the blue asterisks at the bottom of my slides will denote a CARP-funded research project. In addition to club root, we funded three other disease-related research projects. Dr. Gary Ping at AAFC Saskatoon is investigating blackleg resistance, and Dr. Delantha Fernando is finding resistance against Verticillium stripe in canola at the University of Manitoba. These were both CARP-funded projects. At AAFC Lacombe, Dr. Kelly Turkington is continuing work on the Prairie Crop Disease Monitoring Network. Our second goal, finding the best ways to grow canola, only took up two of our 10 projects. One CARP-funded project with Dr. Isabel Parkin is looking to develop climate-ready canola. And another project with Dr. Gavin Chen is researching elevating canola yield, oil, and protein content. In addition to our annual funding, we contributed to the Canola Agriscience Cluster as part of the federally funded Sustainable Canadian Agricultural Partnership. Between Alberta Canola, SaskCanola, Manitoba Canola Growers, and Ontario Canola Growers, with industry and federal funding, the total investment will be more than $17 million over 5 years, and over 17 projects will be carried out in collaboration with public research institutions across Canada. Alberta Canola has a separate $1.5 million budget specifically for the Canola Agriscience Cluster as it comes around every 5 years. Here is just a breakdown of our research funding in core areas since 2012. I just wanted to draw attention to the bottom right, where you can see that our leverage is sitting at around 5.8. This last week, at the end of November, our research committee reviewed 29 full proposals to decide on which projects we would fund for the new year. Between these 29 projects was a funding request of just under $10 million. This year, we had over 10 individuals who contributed their knowledge and expertise to the research proposal reviews to ensure Alberta Canola funds practical, timely, and scientifically sound canola research. And that is all I have to share about Alberta Canola's research programs and the research that's been going on in Alberta. To end, I want to say a big thank you to our many funding partners, including Prairie Canola Groups, the Prairie Crop Groups, ARDAR, WGRF, and Alberta Innovates, as well as the Canola Council of Canada, all those on the Canola Week Committee, and the attending participants. Merry Christmas, everyone. Happy holidays, and thank you for your attention.
All right, thanks a lot, Kathryn. So I'm going to be your next presenter. So I'm Doug Heath, the research manager at SaskCanola, and we oversee roughly 70 research projects every year that are ongoing. And I come from a diverse research and development background, including working in research programs on canola, wheat, camelina, carinata, and pulses. And so I'll be giving the SaskCanola research update. I'd just like to briefly talk today about a couple of timely canola issues that are relevant to farmers and the industry as a whole. The first is about the difficulties in accurate visual diagnosis of verticillium stripe compared to blackleg. And secondly, in this same session last year, as well as at other events, I've heard concerns from farmers about the idea of paying for pre-breeding trait development research and then having to pay again when they buy the seed. So I just want to address these two issues this morning. And I'm not sure why, but this picture reminds me of all the sticky notes on my desk. So the first topic, the problem is it blackleg or verticillium? So this year, SaskCanola added verticillium stripe to its free disease testing program in partnership with the Sask Ministry of Agriculture and Discovery Seed Labs. And with the goal of getting more producers and agronomists questioning whether they might be misdiagnosing verticillium or blackleg. And the program has had a lot more uptake this year with the inclusion of verticillium testing. But visual identification is still not reliable enough in a lot of cases, so it's very difficult to tell the difference even after seeing a lot of stems in the field. So sending samples into a diagnostic lab for PCR confirmation is the most reliable way to make an accurate diagnosis. So the stem on the left is verticillium only, and the one on the right is both diseases, verticillium and blackleg. So it's very difficult to tell the difference in a lot of cases. So often greener stem samples are being sent into the labs for blackleg and verticillium testing, and that's because canola disease surveys are often done at near swathing time. And at that particular time, it's hard to see actually visual symptoms of verticillium in a lot of cases. So if you are collecting blackleg samples, so take the crown samples as usual, but also take a larger piece of the stem to send in for testing for verticillium. And in this particular case, all these stems were blackleg only. And I think with these stems as well, the people that collected them were adamant that verticillium was on them as well, but they were only coming back as blackleg. So. So for green stem samples, So the lab has to take samples from multiple locations along the stem when there aren't visual symptoms. As well, there seems to be a little bit of confusion between the visual identification of blackleg pycnidia. So on the left are the pycnidia and verticillium micular sclerotia in the field is on the right. So extension messaging and experience will help. So with the blackleg pycnidia on the left, the pycnidia are larger on the outside of the stem not limited to a particular pattern, and are raised so you can actually feel the pycnidia with your finger. Whereas the Verticillium microscrotia on the right are much smaller and can be seen once the stem starts to shred or peel, and are often in a straight line trending towards one half of the stem. And you can see here the microscrotia are following the vascular tissue in the stem. So the solution is to use is to submit samples to the diagnostic lab for PCR testing instead of relying on visual diagnosis. Okay, so for the second topic in my talk, I'd like to talk about some of the costs and benefits for farmer-driven pre-breeding trait research by running through some back-of-the-napkin numbers with you. So just to set up a scenario, let's take an example of a 10,000-acre farm or a 15,000-acre farm growing 5,000 acres of canola each year with a yield of 1 ton per acre, which is the same as 44 bushels per acre. A levy at SaskCanola of 75 cents per ton and a canola price of $700 per ton. So in this particular farm, each year canola levy paid would be $3,750, and gross revenue on the canola 5,000 acres would be $3.5 million. And SaskCanola's annual budget is roughly $8 million, so an average germplasm development project would be $100,000 per year, roughly, so that works out to 1.25% of SaskCanola's budget. And so that money, $100,000, can also be leveraged with other funding groups and provincial and federal governments as well. So taking 1.25% of that $3,750 levy, so this particular farm would contribute $47 of their levy towards this one single project in a given year. And on average, a germplasm project will last roughly 3 years. So $47 a year, that means each farm of this size would give $141 towards a germplasm project. And so now just taking a couple of examples of either a 5% yield gain or yield protection, and or a 1% yield gain, just to give a range of numbers. So that works out to, in the case of a 5% yield gain, that would work out to $175,000 per season. So with a one-time investment of roughly $140, you could potentially make $175,000 extra per year once it's in a variety. Or even if it's just a 1% yield gain or protection, works out to $35,000 per season. And so the key point here is that when farmers invest in pre-breeding trait discovery, it eliminates waste and duplication of effort that otherwise would have to be done by each of the canola breeding programs and seed companies. So this buys farmers improved efficiency of trait discovery and also buys them access to those traits by multiple breeders so that the major trait combinations needed for tomorrow's challenges can be had by all breeders. And so then this also frees up commercial breeding budgets to concentrate on other unique breeding innovations for their own competitive advantage. Okay, so I'm just gonna stop there. So thanks a lot.
Good morning. My name is Hossein Borhan. I'm a molecular plant pathology research scientist with Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada in Saskatoon. I'll be chair for the remainder of the session. We have three talks, and we are pressed for time. So given that we have the lunch break coming up, so we will leave the question for the lunch break period. So we won't have question during the talks. I would like to invite our first speakers to the stage, Kaylie, Krys, and Erik Andvaag from University of Saskatchewan. Kaylie is a master candidate in Dr. Steve Shortley's Agronomic Crop Imaging Lab at the University of Saskatchewan. Kaylie's thesis is focused on applying a methodology for use of unoccupied aerial vehicle to count emerging canola plant population at a field scale. Erik Andvaag is an MS candidate in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Saskatchewan. He's an NSERC Canada graduate scholarship master program recipient and two-time NSERC undergraduate student research award recipient. Erik's research project has involved the development of canola counter, an easy-to-use web tool that detects and counts early season canola plants in aerial field imagery. Kaylie and Erik will present on the standard establishment using drone and deep learning tools to evaluate canola stands. Thank you.
So as many of you may know, early season canola population counts are useful indicators of field health. Traditionally, these plant populations have been estimated by manually counting plants within small sample sizes, such as the hoop that you see here. The approach is laborious and time-consuming, and due to this, has a low throughput. And can only provide very fragmented view of the plant emergence rates, especially with the size of fields today. This is because it simply just isn't feasible to count these large of areas by hand. In recent years, an alternative approach to manual plant counts has been proposed. This method works in two steps. First, a drone is used to capture high-resolution aerial images of the field, and then a computer-based object detection model is used to detect and count the plant seedlings within each of the drone images. Today, we will be sharing with you our experience applying this new plant counting approach in canola at the field scale. We wanted this project to be completed with producers and agronomists in mind. So the field application was done using technology and software that is available on the market and accessible. For this reason, we chose the drone of a DJI Mavic 2 Pro, and the sensor that we used was the stock camera that came with this drone, which was an RGB sensor picking up visible light bands. A European field scouting software by AgDrone was used to create point sample drone flights to collect the image sets. Applying the point sample collection rather than imaging the field as a whole created a much smaller, more manageable data set with only 50 images per quarter section or 160 acres rather than hundreds. This also minimized the pre-processing steps as no image stitching was needed to be done. Images just needed to be sorted into which field they came from. When we applied our project at the field scale, when we applied our project at the field scale, we partnered with six canola producers across central Saskatchewan. I flew fields that were a quarter section inside, splitting larger fields down into these 160 acre parcels. In preparation of flying, each quarter section had their field boundary mapped in the flight software. 50 randomized points were then placed within each field. With time, I learned the most efficient way to fly a quarter section is by splitting it in half, as there is less drone battery wasted flying between points. On the screen, you can see an example of a flight map I would use with a typical quarter section. At each white dot, the drone would drop to a height of 2 meters to take an image. The image on the ground would cover approximately 1.5 meters squared and making for 50 sample points throughout the field. With a battery change included, this would take approximately 30 minutes to do in a field, depending on wind speeds. Following the flight, images were then transferred from the drone's SD card onto the computer in preparation for model processing.
So, following image collection, the second step of drone-based plant counting is to apply an object detection model to count the number of plants in each image. So deep learning-based neural networks are the current state-of-the-art method for detecting objects in digital images. And basically, these models, what they do is they learn to recognize characteristic patterns in images. And the way that this is accomplished is by providing human annotated training examples to the model. The model will then try to adjust its internal parameters to produce outputs that match the human-provided labels. And in the process, the model will hopefully learn to capture the salient features of the object of interest. So current models can be very good at detecting objects, but there are some barriers to using them. So specialized hardware and coding expertise are generally both required. And so one of the goals of our research work was to remove some of these barriers and make it easier for agronomists and for producers to work directly with object detection models. So the solution that we came up with is a web-based tool, which we call Canola Counter. So the tool can be designed, or can be used to detect and count canola seedlings in aerial field images. It's designed to be very accessible and to work quickly. So basically, there are three main steps in our Canola Counter workflow. So first, imagery needs to be uploaded to the site. So a user can either upload a set of raw drone images or a single orthomosaic image, which is basically a kind of large composite image that's created by stitching together a set of overlapping drone images. Once the upload has been processed, the image set can then be inspected in the site's workspace page, and from this page, the images can be annotated, detection models can be trained, and model predictions can be requested. And finally, once a result has been generated, the model predictions can be inspected using a variety of tools and interactive charts. And then spreadsheets associated with the result can also be downloaded, which contain the predicted counts for each image and various other accuracy metrics. So in addition to plant counts, there's a variety of other useful information that can potentially be extracted from an aerial field image. And so our Canola Counter tool is able to provide additional outputs that can be useful in the assessment of field health. So this slide here is just highlighting four interesting additional outputs that our tool can provide. So first, our tool can provide plant counts for regions of interest within an image. So in the top left here, a user has drawn a region around a row in the image in order to avoid counting volunteer plants that are growing outside of the row. Secondly, the Canola Counter can provide information about plant spacing. So this is accomplished by just partitioning the image space between the predicted objects. The Canola Counter is also able to quantify the percentage of ground area covered by vegetation. The way this is achieved is by segmenting the image with a vegetation index. Basically, what this means is isolating the green-colored pixels within the image. And additionally, our tool can quantify weed presence by subtracting the vegetation belonging to the predicted plant seedlings from the total amount of vegetation found within the image. And then lastly, we can provide various kinds of density heat maps that show how plant density varies across the imaged area. So this can provide a nice a global picture of stand establishment across a field. So we're often asked questions about the accuracy of drone-based plant counting. And so we conducted this little performance assessment to investigate our tool's ability to produce accurate plant counts. So in this assessment, we used our canola counter tool to train a detection model on a large number of images, and then we tested its performance across a large number of test images. So the chart on this slide is showing the differences between the predicted and annotated number of canola seedlings for each of the test images. So a red line is indicating an image where the predicted count was larger than the annotated count, and a blue line is indicating an image where the predicted count was smaller than the annotated count. And the images are just ordered based on the magnitude of the difference between annotated and predicted count. So we can see that for most of the images that we tested, the difference between annotated and predicted count was really quite small. However, definitely towards the right-hand side of the chart, we can see that there are a handful of images where the difference is fairly substantial. So there is definitely still room for improvement, but we think overall these results are quite encouraging and show that drone-based plant counting has the potential to be quite accurate.
The Canola Council of Canada provides a recommendation of target plant population of 50 to 80 plants per meter squared to be able to maintain that maximum yield potential. This provides some buffer in the spring for post-season plant losses, including frost, disease, insects, and weed competition. If the emerging plant population is too low, plant mortality will have a larger impact on yield potential. At a minimum, the Canola Council recommends canola crops have 30 to 40 plants per meter squared to be able to maintain that yield potential. Using the UAV imagery results processed through the canola counter tool, we can easily visualize, for example, these 9 fields that are across one farming operation. Knowing Canola Council's recommendations can allow us to find overall field patterns, as well as pinpoint troubled fields that may need further investigation. In conclusion, we were able to successfully apply drone-based plant counting to obtain precise seedling counts across large field areas. We were able to develop a detection model that could provide an accurate population counts across a wide variety of fields and image conditions. Additionally, our aerial field images provide us with other useful pieces of field information, such as crop density, ground cover, plant spacing, and weed presence. Following our experience, we can see the possibility of drone-based surveying being applied in tandem with our manual plant scouts. This could allow for an increase in the number of observations across the field, or allow for a traditional size survey to be completed in a more timely manner. This is just one example of how drones and deep learning tools can be used to evaluate canola stands at the field scale. On behalf of Erik and myself, we would like to thank you for having us today, and we look forward to any questions or discussions at lunch or in the networking time. Thank you.
Thank you, Kaylie and Erik, for interesting presentation. So the next speaker is Justine Cornelsen. Justine is the Agronomic and Regulatory Service Manager with BrettYoung Seed. She carries over 10 years of experience in agriculture and environmental science, and from her previous positions with Canola Council of Canada, Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada, and Parks Canada. Justine will tell us about the new emerging disease, Verticillium longiosporum, and provide an update on the state of the disease.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. I didn't realize there's like a whole other room way over here, so hello. I've got, I think, 10 minutes to talk about Verticillium in the last 10 years of just experiences with working with this new emerging disease. So I will jump right into it. I am not a researcher anymore. I am an agronomic enthusiast, so these are going to be a lot of my field experiences with working with this pathogen and disease, mainly in Manitoba and a little bit into Saskatchewan. And because we're here in Alberta today, I do have to introduce the disease because it's not a common thing here. So just quickly, you know, Verticillium stripe, it is a disease caused by the fungal pathogen Verticillium longisporum. This is a, you know, an asexual producing pathogen, and really the key diagnostic feature to determining if you're working with that pathogen is finding the presence of microscrotia. So as for the actual disease it causes within brassica plants and mainly canola that we're worried about, it is a monocyclic disease, but it does thrive in these really hot, dry conditions that we've been seeing across Western Canada the last few years. And what it causes as it moves up and through the plant, through the roots into the, through the vascular tissue into the stems, it causes stem striping or this half stem senescence. And so those are kind of the key features that we're looking for when we're out scouting canola fields. As a background and just introduction to this disease, right, it has only been 10 years of working with it. It was first found on a research farm south of Winnipeg in the fall of 2014. The following year, the Canadian Food Inspections Agency did a really comprehensive survey. They surveyed all across Canada looking for Verticillium longisporum, and they were able to find it in six provinces. So, of course, across Western Canada, where bulk of our canola acres are, it was present. As we move forward, 2016, there was a change in name, and a lot of the European literature was referred to as Verticillium wilt, but now we've shifted to call it Verticillium stripe based on the symptoms we're seeing here in Canada. And one other component too, it's not a regulated pest, and it's not a regulated pest here in Canada or globally in any other countries that are dealing with it. So that's a kind of a good thing. We're able to work with this pathogen and share resources and get some more movement going. As we move into 2018, I kind of consider that the first year where we started to really see more and more symptoms at the field level. This was also the first year where there was research projects that were funded to look at Verticillium stripe, and I guess a lot more seriousness around the subject. But we still have a lot of big questions that need to be answered before we can really move forward in understanding this disease better. And so that's what I'm going to just really jump into is some of my field experience, some of the learnings from this. Been in enough canola fields the last few years to have a really good grasp of what's going on. For me, back in 2016, this was a field I was surveying through the provincial government canola disease survey. Was there in early August, and it was already swath. Really, really damaged plants, lots of blackleg, lots of sclerotinia, and something else was going on. And it was not, it was about a month later I'd come back to the field, and that's what all these images are that post-harvest, you know, month later, to really see the symptoms of Verticillium stripe. At the time, a month earlier, would have never thought that's what I was working with, but seeing and coming back, you could really see the presence of microscrotia across that field. And so for me, it was, my kind of takeaways here was, okay, this is an actual issue. We see some really bad damage. It's not just on a research farm anymore. But it also coexists with other plant pathogens and can be easily misdiagnosed. As we move forward, 2018, I was in quite a few canola fields for my master's work looking for blackleg, and there's nothing more infuriating than finding something else than the disease you want to find. I was there to rate blackleg cross-section cuts, and in a lot of my stems, I was finding this gray discoloration. So this was at that standard, you know, 60% seed color change. That's when we typically go in to rate canola for disease presence, and was getting this, I don't know what was going on. And you know, it was a field that, thankfully, right along the highway, I was able to stop at every week and really watch the progression of the disease. And so this was my early indicators of what to be looking for. And never did I think that a Snapchat photo would be so commonly used within the industry. Already saw it earlier today. This is kind of the go-to early diagnostic image. And you can see the difference there within that root cross-section cuts. So just really another takeaway in pushing that emphasis of, you know, that standardized timing to when to be looking for this disease. It's not obvious. It's not early on. And it's likely for years been misdiagnosed as something like blackleg or even sclerotinia. 2020. We're moving into drought years. It's getting hot and dry in Manitoba, and this is where we started to see those symptoms earlier on. So now we've got the environmental conditions for this pathogen to cause the disease early on and show us the microscrotia. So this was just a neighbor's field, just doing some snooping, seeing what's going on. We had a little bit of upfront moisture, and that's where we get some sclerotinia symptoms, and it's not looking for verticillium, you have to slough off that outer stem wall to reveal the microscrotia. That is a really key diagnostic feature here. And like I said, looks so similar to sclerotinia. So through this, you know, we've gained a lot of, you know, field experience with working with this, right? 10 years ago, didn't even know this was a thing or a possibility here in Canada. And now we're starting to get a feel of what to be looking for and how it was missed. So lots of comparatives and how, like I said, easily it was misdiagnosed for something like blackleg. Just a quick shout out to 2023 and what we were seeing this year. Once again, hot, dry conditions should have been really, really good for verticillium to develop. In areas in northern Saskatchewan, we started to see rain throughout the month of September. We saw a lot of gray stem. And in those diagnostic reports, that's what we are starting to see as well, is come back as that. So not necessarily verticillium in a lot of those fields, but it is starting to move and spread. So we've got resources in place. The Canola Council has been able to really utilize these field experiences to generate content to help the industry, you know, properly scout and identify verticillium stripe from other diseases. So lots of great extension tools. And this becomes really important when we're looking at changing or adopting new management practices. And especially when we look at an integrated pest management approach, right, the first step is knowing what you're working with. And unfortunately, that's one of the only management tactics we have right now for verticillium, is properly identifying it in the field. You know, if you're able to find it, or if you're able to, you know, properly diagnose and find out something like blackleg, you have options for that disease. You don't for verticillium right now. So we know what to be looking for, and now we're trying to figure out where is verticillium and how bad is it across the prairies. Manitoba is the hotspot and continues to be that hotspot. I'm not going to dive into all the specifics. I know there's a lot of content there on the slides, but I just want to look at some of the trends over the last 5 years. So David Kaminsky supplied just the disease prevalence in Manitoba for the big, we'll call it the big three. Club root for us is still kind of, we'll find a few fields. So you can see sclerotinia is so environmentally dependent. You see the variances there. Blackleg, pretty well you can go to any field and find at least one piece of canola or one piece of stem that's showing blackleg. So we see it in 80% of our fields in Manitoba. And now we see this verticillium starting to increase. And prevalence, for the prevalence, for a field to be rated as showing the disease, all it needs is one plant stem to actually show it, or one plant. So two things in why we're seeing the verticillium stripe increase. We now know what to be looking for. So we've got surveyors that are able to identify it in the field, and then we follow up with diagnostic testing afterwards. And then the other component is we've turned into a drought in Manitoba. Hot, dry conditions, which have been really, really favorable for disease development, and another reason why we're seeing it increase. I do want to note that the decrease a little bit in 2023. One big component, and when you look at the survey data, bulk of the canola fields that were surveyed through the province were surveyed really early. So they're in that early kind of 2 weeks in August, missing a lot of the verticillium symptoms that come in later. So that's one key piece to note. Amy mentioned the Pest Surveillance Initiative Lab, right? There's grower-funded surveys out there, testing out there, and out of all of the samples the last 3 years that have gone to PSI to look for blackleg and verticillium, 98% of them are showing verticillium longisporum. So it's there and present and prevalent. And we are starting to see a similar trend in Saskatchewan now. Around 40% of those samples were showing verticillium longisporum. So timing is everything when we are trying to survey and find verticillium. So that'll continue to, I guess, cause us some issues, but it's something to really take into consideration when we're looking at survey results. So as for priorities, we still have so many big questions. A lot of these are Canola Council research priorities, so they're available online, and really what I find at the field level as well. You know, the big questions that growers are asking and are wanting answers for, right? Number one is, what are the yield losses? What's the damage that could be caused from this? There's lots of questions around harvest method. So the later those plants are staying out of the field, right, the longer that pathogen's able to colonize and potentially cause more damage and build more inoculum. When we start to look into breeding trials, we see huge differences in the hybrid maturity and that impact on verticillium. So how do you take maturity into your ratings? One of our biggest holdbacks before we can even answer those types of questions is we need a disease severity scale in place for the industry to use, right? And we need to then know when's the best time to actually get into the field and to be surveying and taking in, taking all of that into consideration on what those eventual losses could be. Relationships with other pathogens, right? We see verticillium with Leptospira maculans in a lot of fields. So who's opening the door for first? Who's causing the damage? And we're starting to see maybe a little bit of inconsistencies in lab procedures and reporting. So these are just some other things that we really need to iron out before we can move forward with finding some better management tactics. And that's really the last one. Right now, when we speaking with growers, there's not a lot of options out there. There's been a really good investment into finding resistant traits and bringing resistant hybrids to market, and they are there and they're waiting, and they're some are out in the marketplace right now. But really, we don't have a clear, concise answer to exactly how well those are going to work, and we need to start looking at some other cultural options for this disease before it really takes off. Yesterday we had a great verticillium workshop. It's something that it was just great to get everyone together to speak about this disease, learn from each other, and collaboration going ahead is going to be so extremely important, and utilizing the resources that are out there, utilizing the disease surveys that happen through the provincial governments, the research dollars that are invested through the federal government and through grower organizations, right? If we can all get together, we'll hopefully have some more answers, and in the next 5 years, maybe we'll be able to talk more further on some management tactics. So with that, I will wrap up because I think my time is now officially up. And I've probably generated way more questions than I have answered, which is always my goal, so.
Thank you, Justin, for a really good update on a new disease, and we know very little about it. So the next speaker of this session is Dr. Charles Geddes. Dr. Charles Geddes is a wheat scientist at Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada in Lethbridge, Alberta. Charles grew up in a mixed farm near Pilot Mound, Manitoba. He graduated with a BSc in agroecology and a PhD in plant science from the University of Manitoba. Charles leads the Prairie Herbicide-Resistant Wheat Survey and research on the discovery, characterization, monitoring, and management of herbicide-resistant wheat in Western Canada. Charles talks today about the herbicide-resistant wheat and the tragedy of short-term thinking.
Okay, thanks very much. I'd like to start off just by thanking everyone for the invitation to come talk about herbicide-resistant weeds. This is really my area of research. We look at discovery, monitoring, and management of herbicide resistance. This is a big title and a really short amount of time to present it. So things are going to be very, very high level here. So in general, we're talking about herbicide resistance. So recently, we did a bit of, it was, I guess, a meta-analysis, but we looked at weed science trials on canola across the prairies and also into the United States to try and determine what is the impact of weeds on canola yield. So can anyone guess if we allow weeds to grow in our canola, how much yield does it actually rob? Anyone have a guess? 5%? 30%? Somebody read the paper, I think. That's on average, it came to 30% across 89 trials on the Canadian prairies, but then also into the United States a little bit as well. So herbicide-resistant weeds. This is the map of herbicide resistance globally, looking at the number of unique herbicide-resistant weeds by country. In Canada, we're in third place, you could say, which is not necessarily a good thing. We're behind the United States and Australia for the greatest number of unique herbicide-resistant weeds. What that looks like in Canada, this is just showing the discovery of new herbicide-resistant weed biotypes over time. And so when I'm presenting on unique herbicide-resistant weeds, it's the combination of a weed species resistant to a herbicide mode of action. So we're sitting at about 86 across the country, and this is, it's increasing in a linear fashion. We're discovering about two new biotypes every year. And of course, increasing herbicide resistance is an issue when we consider that we have a limited number of herbicide modes of action with which we can manage these weeds. This figure is just showing the release of new herbicide modes of action or groups over time. And you can, at first look, it looks like, wow, there's actually a lot of groups there. And so the ones in red are ones that we would be using to a larger degree in our cropping system. Some of those we don't really use here. And you can see that that timeline essentially plateaus in the 80s, where we've been 30 to 40 years now with one new herbicide site of action. So one of the projects that I lead are the Prairie Herbicide Resistant Weed Surveys. And so we cover about 800 fields, randomly selected fields across the three prairie provinces over 4 years. We visit those fields as soon before harvest as we can, and we survey those fields for visible uncontrolled weed patches. We would then visit those patches, collect viable seed or mature seed from the patches, and they come back to our research center where we test them for herbicide resistance. So this is just showing the most recent survey in Saskatchewan, where we surveyed 419 fields. And overall, what we found was that about 72% of the fields where we collected weeds and tested them had some form of herbicide resistance present. Herbicide resistance occupied roughly about half of the acres within that field. This is on average across those 419 fields sampled. In the top corner there, you can see a figure that is increasing. That is the percentage of fields in each of the three provinces that have some form of herbicide resistance present. So we're currently sitting roughly around 3/4 of the fields that are tested. And so we can aggregate this information all together, also with farmer reported values of the cost of herbicide resistance to come up with metrics in what do farmers think herbicide resistance actually costs them. And in this case, it's $340 million a year across Saskatchewan. Now looking at Manitoba here. So the Manitoba survey took place in 2022. We surveyed 155 fields because the number of fields is stratified based on cultivated area. And we saw similar results as well. Roughly about 3/4 of the fields that are tested have some form of herbicide resistance present, and in those fields it's occupying about half of the acres. So when we aggregate it all together, herbicide resistance costs Manitoba farmers an estimated $81 million a year. And so for Alberta, we don't yet have the results from the Alberta survey. It took place in 2023, so we'll have those results to show you in the future. So what are these pesky weeds that I'm talking about? So this is a poster that I recently developed that is just showing the various weed species and types of resistance that we have on the Canadian prairies. You can see it's organized into the activity or their area of activity in the plant, but then also based on their mode of action. And so especially looking at this figure, a lot of people are surprised about the number of group 2 resistant weeds. So these are grass and broadleaf weeds that we have across the prairies. There is a lot of group 2 resistance out there. So this list is just kind of myself brainstorming on what I think are some of the biggest issues in herbicide resistance on the prairies. So the top one there being group 1 and 2 herbicide resistant grass weeds that are causing fairly heavy reliance on soil-applied residual herbicides. So if you think about group 1 and 2 resistant wild oat or green foxtail, for example, Next on the list there is spread of five-way herbicide-resistant kochia. So on the prairies, we know we have resistance to four of those different groups currently, and group five in that list is, we know, is just south of the border, and we haven't really been testing for it in Western Canada. So it could be here already. We have heavy reliance on glyphosate at multiple use windows, so both pre-seed, but then also in crop, pre-harvest in some cases, and post-harvest, as well as advancing these invasive amaranth species. So in a previous talk, it was mentioned water hemp in Manitoba, but also Palmer amaranth. It was confirmed in Manitoba. And we do expect these to move their way westward as well. And then finally, spread of these group two resistant weeds, broadleaf weeds, that sort of large group of group two resistant weeds that we have currently at very low acreage, but certainly does have the potential to spread. So just an example here, this is herbicide resistant kochia, combining the three post-harvest kochia surveys across the prairie provinces. So aggregating it all together, we had roughly, in the mid-800s of fields that were surveyed between 2018 and 2021, and we confirmed glyphosate resistance in roughly three-quarters of those fields, and dicamba resistance in just under a quarter of those fields across the prairies. You can see Manitoba has a little bit less dicamba resistance than the other prairie provinces. But what we're not showing here also is fluroxypyr resistance, which we do know to occur on the prairies. Also not shown here is group 2 resistance. We know essentially all kochia populations have some level of group 2 resistance. And the more recent one is group 14 resistance, or PPO inhibitor resistance, which we did confirm in Saskatchewan in 2021. So we do know this type of resistance to be out there, but only known to occur in one field in Saskatchewan to date. But we also, working with North Dakota State University, it's been confirmed in several fields in North Dakota as well. So this is the story for herbicide resistance in kochia, and I'll just touch on this briefly, just demonstrating the speed at which herbicide resistance can spread. So glyphosate resistance in kochia on the prairies was first documented in 2011, and the survey the subsequent year in 2012 found glyphosate resistance in 4% of those populations that were sampled. And there you'll see 100% ALSR, or acetylactate synthase inhibitor resistance, which is just group 2 resistant kochia. Fast forward 5 years in 2017, group 2 resistance still present in all of the samples. Glyphosate resistance had increased from 4% to 50% of those populations sampled. As well, dicamba resistance in 18%, and fluroxypyr resistance, both two auxin-mimic herbicides, or group 4s, fluroxypyr was in 13% of those populations. Now, 2021 is our most recent survey for Alberta, and what we found was glyphosate resistance now in 78% of those populations that were sampled, so from 4% to 78% in 10 years. As well, dicamba resistance in 28% and fluroxypyr resistance in 44% of those samples. So one of the issues that's leading to this is oversimplification of our weed control programs, right? So we have a large focus on chemical weed management. There's also some thoughts about cultural and physical weed management, but they do really take a minority role in our current systems. And we do need to be moving more toward an integrated weed management program where we're seeing physical, cultural, and biological tools implemented along with our herbicides to further diversify our weed control options and make the system a bit more sustainable. This, of course, is a broad oversimplification of what's going on, but this is really where we do need to go to help combat herbicide resistance. So I'll end the talk here, but really, we do know herbicide resistance is a growing issue for farmers in Western Canada, but also globally. And so understanding herbicide resistance is one of the keys to helping manage this issue and also mitigate the development of herbicide resistance. And there really is no silver bullet, but we do know that effective options are out there. So I'd like to thank again everyone for listening. We have a long list of funders that support our research on herbicide resistance, and especially the canola commissions and groups across the prairies are very supportive of our research. And this research, I mean, it really takes a team to do it, right? So most of our team here shown on the slide. So it's really their work, and I'm the guy that communicates it. So thanks for listening.
Thank you, Charles. Please join me for thanking all the speakers of this session for the wonderful talks that they had. With that also, I would like to the conference wouldn't be possible without our sponsors. And I would like to thank BASF and Bayer that they are the top sponsor of this event. Also, big thanks to Proven Seeds for sponsoring the students that we have here today in the conference, Alberta Canola, Corteva, High Tech Production Limited, Manitoba Canola Growers, SaskCanola, and also our other sponsor of this conference. The conference wouldn't be possible without the support of Canadian Canola Growers Association, New Seed, BrettYoung Seed, DL Seeds, Syngenta, Western Grain Research Foundation, and Winfield United. So before we go for lunch, I would like to invite Blaine from BASF to come to the stage.
Thank you, Hassan. Appreciate that. And I also appreciate you didn't try my last name, so thanks a lot. Welcome to Canola Week. Very exciting to be a platinum sponsor. My name is Blaine Wojcicin. I'm the marketing manager for Invigor Canola from BASF. Been doing that role for about 14 years. I've also had the pleasure of being with Invigor from pretty well day one as a rep in the field. So it's a pleasure to sponsor this. For the last 26 years, a lot of my life has been Invigor. 200 million acres later for us in Vigor with Bayer and with BASF. It's been indeed a pleasure. But, some of the things we want to make sure people understand our leadership position and our responsibility to the Canadian canola industry as a whole. With our pod shatter technology, patented pod shatter technology, over 60 some million acres grown to date, and our first generation and second generation club root resistance, 38 million acres. We feel a very big responsibility to the Canadian canola growers and the industry as a whole. So one of the things we'd like to do is invite everyone tomorrow to the Invigor Happy Hour, where we'll be launching our position on our first and second generation club root genetics along the line of some of our positioning as well. We believe that'll be very beneficial. It's time for us to do this. It'll be very beneficial for the Canadian canola grower to understand what to grow in our position on this one as an industry leader. So we thank you. We thank you for coming, and we also hope we can buy you a craft beer tomorrow. And a lot of our leaders from our breeding team, our marketing, our tech service will be there to answer any questions you have at our Q&A table over a beer. So thank you very much again.
That brings us to the end of this session, and we can go for the lunch break that it is in the hallway down there where we had the breakfast this morning. Lunch is sponsored with BASF, and thank you all for your presence, and the next session would be at 1 p.m. It is on biofuel, and we'll see you at 1 p.m. here. Thank you.